Okay, perfect. Thank you. Okay, welcome. Thank you for coming today. Hi to those of you who are watching on Zoom. Today we have CLC sociologist Gary Payne. And I don't know how many years you've been here, Gary.
Too many.
We're so fortunate because not only is he an instructor, but he also is a great photographer. So he will be talking to us about the Alaskan Indians and three trips to Alaska. CLC sociologist Gary Payne constructed the story by studying letters and photos from Alaska's museums and the Alaskan Historical Society documents, and then added his own images, as I mentioned, of Alaska's magnificent terrain and wildlife to animate a story rarely told. So please join me in welcoming Gary Payne.
Well, I was afraid you'd applaud, and that implies that you expect a good presentation. I'll do my best here. And I'm taking my mask off here because the way we have set the rules, as long as people are, you know, 14, 15 feet away, I can do that. I am triple vaccinated. So I was just telling Bob Brecken here, the next thing I'll do is armor plate all over myself. Okay, well, I'm glad you're here, and I want to thank Tracy and Andrea Carlson for helping me put this together. They've been a pit crew for me. This is a complex operation because I'm using two different CDs and we're putting it to music and it's timed and we're starting one in the middle of a cut. It's ridiculous. But so you're part of an experiment here and we hope it goes well. Of course, I think we should probably start with Columbus. I mean, I don't think there's anybody in the room that really thinks that Columbus discovered America anymore, right? That's a myth that lasted a long time. And it's dying out slowly. And the reason it's dying out slowly is there's nothing been put in its place. This myth was important for our cultural self-esteem, evidently, right? And we taught this for generation after generation for five centuries.
Excuse me, can you speak up a little? I'm a little hard of hearing and I can't afford a hearing aid.
I've seen that commercial and I know this guy is a joker, but if you really aren't having trouble, move up closer, okay?
I'll try harder.
All right, so now to get back to where I was here, it was an important part of our cultural self-esteem to think that we discovered America and this is just a great story from beginning to end. But we're a culture like so many others, imperfect. And so it seems to me like it's really time for a new story because what we have now without Columbus in the mix, we have this vague, disconnected, uncohesive story about who discovered America. And so not only are we still somewhat in the Columbus myth, but we have a vacuum that needs to be filled because there are people that should be honored for what they've done. And they did it a long, long, long time before Columbus and they discovered a lot more than America. And so, watching all the documentaries that I've watched in my life and I just love documentaries and PBS done many great things. But I've never seen the story told from the very beginning into the modern day, which is a lot to do in an hour. So I'm gonna have to start talking faster towards the end. I actually have more than 200 slides and they're very worried about this. So we gotta get going. Okay, so I have the dates up there and I'm gonna start trimming down the contrast. That one's gonna go this far because I don't think you need any more than that. And I gathered this data from University of Alaska and places. All these things are from the historical societies or letters that I've read from historical societies or photos from museums or that kind of thing. In terms of sources, it's fine if you don't want to trust it, but I've done the best I can. So it could be as early as 40,000 years ago, the first Asians who became our American Indians crossed. We don't know for sure, but that is an estimate. 16,000 years ago, some people in the University of Alaska think we've got enough proof to say that they were here 16,000 years ago. BP means before present, right? which is universal. We don't say BC anymore because not everybody, I believe, are impressed. So, but 12,000 years ago, we have some really solid evidence. There's 69 archaeological digs in the south central part of Alaska now. They've got hearths. There's no doubt about it. They've carbon dated it and they've luminance dated it. And we know that they were here 120 centuries ago. And that's going to go back further, I'm sure, because recently, in a find that hasn't been completely certified yet in South America, in the nation of Colombia, there's been a finding that dates to 12,000 years ago. So it does look like this is going to go back maybe, you know, maybe all the way to 40,000 years. You know, who knows? But they were here a long time before Columbus. Columbus, the Vikings, they're not even players. They're not in the game. It is just our desire for cultural self-esteem, I think, that keep these stories rolling. That doesn't mean that Columbus and the Vikings and others shouldn't be studied or known, but it's ridiculous to spend so much time on them and neglect the people that really deserve the credit. So that's what I want to do here as fast as I can. All right, I'll try clicking this and seeing if this works. Yes, I can be trained. Okay, so now we're all Africans under the skin. Doesn't matter where you came from, what your race is. We all came from Africa. The DNA, and I have my DNA on my tie today, has proven beyond a doubt for anybody who's interested in science that we all came from Africa. And I've been to East Africa. I've been to Ethiopia and Somalia here in the Rift Valley. This is where humanity got its start. And there were, you know, three models of humans, the early model, Homo erectus, and the Neanderthals, and they're color-coded here, but they died out. Long story, don't have time for it. But Homo sapiens, and that's who we are, Homo sapiens, you know, were the latest model, and they were more intelligent, they had bigger brains, they were more curious, and about 100,000 years ago, they started leaving Africa. And when they did, some of them went west, okay? And that's where Western civilization comes from. That's why we call it Western civilization. And that's where we, those of us in this room, most of us at least, we have our philosophers. That's where we get our religious ideas. That's where we get our laws from England here, right? And this is where we get our Irish whiskey right here. And but this is, there was a big turning point here. And actually, even Islam is considered at least on the edge of Western civilization. After all, we share some of the same religious prophets, right? Like Abraham, depending on where you are on that side of the line. And so, when they got this far, things began to change. And thousands of years began to separate the two civilizations, which became unknown to each other for many, many years. Later on, there was trading, but not at this time. These were separate civilizations. These people who went east, we haven't studied them much. They're not our people. We don't know their names. We don't know their philosophers or their religious ideas. And they went on, if we get this thing to work, they went on and some of them went up north. And some of them, look where they went. These are the real explorers of this earth. I mean, it's hard to believe how little we know about them. And look where they went. Let's go down here first. Down, you know, through Indonesia and Australia. The Aborigines were people from the, you know, that went east, the Eastern people, we could call them, or Eastern civilization people, we could call them. And by the time they got here, you know, we in Alaska, we call them Indians. But look at this, look where they went compared to us. We stayed around here. And there's no reason to leave. These were great temperate, warm spots where you could raise a lot of crops and do a lot of things. So there's no reason, I guess, to leave this area. But these people went right through India, right through China, and on and on and on through Siberia. And then we think around 10,000 years ago, somewhere in there, they began crossing regularly, and the oceans were lower then. There was more ice, less ocean, and they got across the Bering Straits. And then they went And see, this is 15,000. I gave you the 12,000 years. Their estimate was 15,000. So, you know, these are estimates. 15,000, that's 150 centuries ago. Down through Alaska, they went all through Canada. They went over to Greenland and Iceland, although they never stayed at Iceland. And they, you know, went and basically created hundreds of cultures in the United States. By the time they got to this area here in Mexico, the Yucatan Peninsula and Guatemala and Belize, they created the Maya Empire, which lasted 18 centuries. Rome was only 400. And then when they went down into South America, to make a very long story short, it was the Inca Empire, which some would say was, you know, one of the greatest empires in the world, and perhaps the greatest. When you see some of the things they did, I wouldn't get to see some of those things. Go see Machu Picchu and some of these, you know, the monument to the sun and the moon. And, you know, stones weighing more than all of us put together, and this room and its materials. They were moved 40 miles to make these stones that fit together so tight you can't put a human hair between them. I've seen them. They're amazing. These people were amazing people. And then they finally ended their trip in Cuba, okay? Because they came around these islands, which you can barely see, but you on a still day, you might be able to canoe across them. And these were the explorers. They took a chance. Some of them probably drowned doing it, but they discovered Cuba finally here. That was their last, that was the last frontier. 3,500 years ago, 3,000 years before Columbus came, they were done. They'd seen it all. They deserve some credit. So, now there's a difference in these cultures too, and there's debates about it. Western culture is seen as highly competitive compared to Eastern culture, right? There's exceptions. Genghis Khan was a huge Mongolian exception, right? Killed lots and lots and lots of people. There were wars in all these, in Indian tribes too, there are disputes, there've been wars, there've been killings, but much less than you see in the Western nations where we are always at war. My students today, a lot of them have never been at a time when we weren't at war. That's normal for us. They couldn't even point out the places, most of them, and neither could I at their age, that we're at war. So we are, you know, Homo sapiens warus or something like that. And in the East, it's less of that. And they are more cooperative. Now, some people say it's because in China, and other low places like Vietnam and Cambodia and Laos, they needed to flood the rice fields at the same time and drain them at the same time. They had to work together, had to, and that made them cooperative. That's probably at least somewhat true. The other thing is religious ideas. And that's touchy stuff to talk about. But if you take a look at the Bible and you see, you know, what can happen to blasphemers and heretics, people that don't believe, and even inside our culture, what happens to people who are heretics or blasphemers, with the penalty was death. And so, and the whole idea of individual salvation and damnation made us into very individualistic people. And there are probably other variables that I don't know about, and, you know, or maybe even more important. That's just a general view, but anthropologists and sociologists agree that we are more competitive, more aggressive than the Eastern cultures, okay? Okay, so what you see then, when you take a look, this is an old picture that's not very good shape, but, you know, this is the kind of sport that cooperative cultures have. They tend to wanna do things where everybody can participate. Doesn't matter your age, doesn't matter how old you are, doesn't matter if you've only got one arm, you can still help, you can still jump, you can do things and everybody has fun, everybody gets a turn. If you take a look at kids in this culture in their early years before they run through our competitive institutions, they'll play catch, they'll do all kinds of things, balloon bopping, keep the thing off the ground. The whole idea being, we'll do this, it's us against gravity, not against each other. And once they get through our institutions though, they're, you know, look at our you know, people in the Super Bowl, you know, the destructive things they do to themselves to get, you know, to get, to the top. But it's more about us over there. And here it's about me and my freedom and my liberty. And so there's a difference. And there's benefits of both ways. All right. I'm sure there's people think, well, wait a minute here. That's fine. Maybe you're right entirely. Okay, so we should know something about these ancient cultures where they dug up these totem poles and things like that, religions and about spirits that have nothing to do with a single male god in the sky that you can't see. You know, maybe they got something to tell us, but we don't know anything about it, right? And we and most of the field, like me, being baptized and also going to Bible schools when I was a kid, not really imagining that someone else had the right idea, because we have the right idea, right? Religiously. So one of the things I want to do first that I hope works is get these people, whoops, started already. I'm going to go back here, maybe stop. And it did. And so that slide that you're going to see is the band that plays all kinds of music. They're Indians from Alaska, and they can play all kinds of modern music. They've evolved, just like we have. But they also like to sing their traditional songs. And I want to show you slides of these, of the oldest pictures we can get of Alaskans, because it gives us an idea of what they were like. Now this is, you know, some dates back to 1880, so don't expect them to be standing there looking modern, right? And, you know, they're not. But I'll give a chance to look back as far as we can into history and see what they look like. And later on, I'm gonna show you another slide, and I can put to the same band's music, but it's gonna be the modern people using their modern music. And one of the cool things they're doing is using a didgeridoo in that one, because it's an Aboriginal instrument and that's Eastern stuff. And they've really glommed onto it. So both times it's Pamua is the name of the group. And when I hit this, I think the music's gonna start. So I've gotta get ready here now. So I think I just hit play and then hit this slide, right? All right, we'll see. All right. Let's go one more here. I got to flip over here now. All right. So that's the best we could do in terms of going back in time, giving an idea of what they look like before there was too much Western influence changing them. So when, you know, no matter where you are, even if you're out in space, you can't take a picture of this planet without finding something in it that they discovered. And sometimes it's all of it, like this picture, every bit of it, and more than you could show. So they're amazing people. Alaska itself the story is just so ridiculous that we bought this from Russia. We're going to talk about that. But it's so big. You could put about five Minnesotas in that if you put it all together. And I assume superimposed it here to give you an idea of what the size of it really stretches clear across the United States in terms of its actual length. There's hundreds of tribes or bands at least. And these people in these colored areas like this blue or this green, they share the same language. If you ask them, are they the same as these, but they say, no, they're different, you know, but they share the same language. And that's really, at least for anthropologists, we think that's really a clue as to that they're kind of the same. And we can sort of group them a little bit, because otherwise, how are you gonna figure out 220, you know, bands, right? Here in Minnesota, we've got the Mille Lacs band, we've got the Red Lake band, you know, we've got the White Earth band, and they're all part of the Ojibwa tribe. And that's what they've got going on there. And some of them are real friendly and some of them are not, but they're getting along, you know, well enough. Okay, so everything that happened that transferred this away from the Indians to Russia at first happened down here on this island, which is Baranof Island, in the place called Sitka. We're gonna be talking about it. But the people that transferred it, they hadn't even been to the interior of Alaska. They'd never been to the north of Alaska. They had no possession of Alaska. They hadn't been there for very long. There's only a few hundred of them. Well, there was 80,000 Indians, maybe as few as 60,000, if there's estimates, right? This is called 60,000, be conservative. But 60,000 is more than 400 to 500, you know what I mean? And how do you sell some 80,000 people's land or 60,000 people's land if you haven't lived there? You know, or take it over for that matter. And this is that story. Well, first of all, I want to talk about why they would live there. You know, for a lot of us, we think, oh, it's so cold in Alaska, we want to live there. But you live there because it's holy. It's so beautiful, you can't even imagine. If you're watching this on Zoom or even here now, you know, it's borders on the unbelievable. And these are just some landscape shots. I wish I had time. Take a look at the size of those trees on top. Those are virgin trees, great big trees. But you can see the cliff that it's on. Fantastic stuff, icebergs floating by. And I have to go through these fast because I've shifted into instructor mode and I'm talking too much. It's what I do for a living, is talk too much. So, you know, this is what, you know, a luxury to be able to live here, to fish here. And it was easy. Living, I always thought, God, it must be terrible. No, it's easy. They lived in an easy place to live and beautiful. That's why they stayed. Some left, but a lot of them stayed and toughed out the winters because this was the most beautiful place. That's a volcano that's extinct outside of Sitka, Alaska. If you're sitting in Sitka, you can always see that place. But that's kind of stuff you can see. And if you don't have much money, you get up there. Tickets are pretty bad, but if you just walk the trails, you'll see everything you need to see, including whales from the trails. When I first got here, the first thing I saw was this totem pole, and a young eagle landed on it for me and stayed there while I set my cameras up and took this picture. And that kind of set the trend for what this trip was like. Tracy said three times, I've since counted, I've been up to Alaska four times, and it's just an unbelievable place, wherever you go. Wildlife is plentiful up there, very plentiful compared to here. And I have to go through this fast. This is an endangered species. This is an American dipper. It eats fish eggs. It goes underwater, swims underwater, grabs a fish egg, and then comes up and looks for something else. And there's very few of them, so I was lucky to get that picture. Plenty of eagles up there because it's perfect. Eagles like to eat fish, and there's nothing but fish out there. I took these pictures. Here's one dragging a salmon, a giant salmon, out of the water. Lucky to get this picture. And that's a glacier behind it, that big blue thing there that's melting. We're staying, see all those pieces at the bottom, according to the screen. All those pieces at the bottom, glacier falling off. We just sat there and the whole bunch of scientists actually on this trip out there. I had my son with me, but the rest of them were all scientists. And they're just watching these glaciers melt, our reflectors, the Earth's reflectors, melting, and it's falling off and hitting the water. And you know, at any rate, this eagle drags this thing. It's about its own weight, and it flew 300 yards to some ice and ate it there. Here's a one-eyed, one-legged eagle. It's not very pretty, but that it could stay alive is a testament to how good Alaska is for eagles. It could still live with one eye and one leg. Seals. My son took this one. Got to give him credit for this picture. Came right up to the boat. Otters. They are the cutest thing ever. They are a teddy bear that is live. And they have more hair than any other creature on Earth. And it captures so much air in between the hairs that it can float. And floats all day on its back, which you wouldn't think is a good idea with orca whales around. Or, you know, they call killer whales, but they're actually dolphins. But so there's a lot of chances to get a picture of an otter on top of the water. They are the cutest things. Okay, can you see the mountain goat? That's usually, and that's with a telephoto lens, major telephoto lens, to get that close to it. And I thought, well, I'll never get that close. But one time on trip, I did finally get close to one, and it had a baby, mom and the kid. Sea lions, you get close to them, you start seeing these big ones, like this guy in the middle. He's got a harem. And there's another big one over here. There's a big guy up here. And they fight each other all day long. And here's a bale coming up to try to get in here. This guy's already yelling at him. And he's going to attack him here shortly. You can see the scars and blood all over him. But they are as big as the grizzlies. They weigh as much, and they're as big. They're just monstrous. And they want their females to sing to them. Which is probably the way it ought to be, don't you think? I mean, Mary doesn't sing to me very often. She's got to, you know, step up her game. So she's going to be here tonight. No one tell her what I just said. She'll be here for the Tonight Show. Okay, so here they are singing together. You talk about some harmony there. But that's the kind of thing. They wanted to see it too. They got off on it, right? The Indians. And the bears they have there are a mix between grizzly and polar bears, and they're called coastal bears. And they're amazing. They're huge. They're bigger than grizzlies, but they are pretty docile in terms of humans. Sitka Island, Baranof Island, where Sitka is, has a higher density of these bears than anywhere else in the world. 1.5 per square mile. That's a lot. You're in the woods, there's a good chance you're not too far from one of these bears. And all the time we were there, for about 8 days, we walked the trails nonstop. Everybody's carrying a gun or bear spray, and we're just like, hi, Mr. Bear, you know. And we never saw him, and that's fine with me. The reason I got these pictures, we went to a reserve where you can get in this building, and the bears come around, and they can't probably get to you, right? And so I took some pictures, and I got lucky that there was a lot there that day, and they fought. So I'll show you a couple pictures of that. This is what they eat, berries of all things, little berries like that start like this. And some of them were a little further along, made it like a large raspberry or blackberry. And they just eat those by the gazillions all day long. And I don't know if they get enough protein, but of course there's the occasional hiker. but they're boy, they are so big that, you know, their heads are like this across. Massive creatures. And these were playing here. And then it turned nasty and the ears went back. And, you know, then they start snagging each other. Look at those claws on them. Look at the claws on that guy. There's another close-up of claws. I like that picture. And that's on the trail. We saw those tracks all the time. And we thought, oh, geez, you know, this is not going to be fun walking forward anymore here. No. But we never saw them. I think they're just real shy. These are some things you see. You know, some of these are taken from trails. Those are orcas and humpbacks. And here's one picture of my family when they saw it. A tree was here, so I couldn't get that picture, so I took the picture of them instead.
That's the shock that you get in the wide open mouth of the
of my grandson here. And this is, I know it looks posed, I don't care,
it's true.
But it's amazing, it looks like a semi-truck just jumped out of the water right next to you and went down. You think, did I see that? That was insane. I hope you get to see one. Okay, I'm gonna show you other pictures of them and what their lives were like. But a lot of people would like to think, well, yeah, that's too bad about things, but you know, they were kind of primitive. No, they weren't. They were highly developed. They were doing as well as we are. Our life expectancy in 1880, that's when the gold rush hit, we'll be talking about that in a second, was lower than 40, somewhere in 38, 39. You know, and we weren't living that long, and neither were they. I mean, you know, they had their problems, and most of it was infant mortality on both. But, don't take from their stuff, their old stuff that we have pictures of, that they were primitive, because they were not. In fact, when you start looking at them, tough as they may look there, they look better than some of these gold miners that I've seen pictures of in the same time. If you had a canoe, though, life was easy. You get in that canoe, birch bark canoe, make it yourself. You don't have to go to Fleet Farm. And you go down here, and here's your salad, all you want. More than you can eat is perfectly washed, no contaminations, because they didn't pollute like we did. It's all salt water washed for you already, so you no bacteria on it. You just go out there and pick it. There's many kinds. This is low tide. And they call themselves the people of the low tide, the Tlingit group in this Baranof Island, where all the action was politically. And so they went out there and gathered that up. And not only did they gather that up, here's some kelp. They call it kelp forests. They're underwater, but they're forests. And that stuff is 8 feet long. I've seen leaves of it 8 feet long. It's good for you. It's way better than this lettuce that we get at the store. No, they were doing all right. And they didn't have to pay. They just walked out and picked it up. And they could also pick up all kinds of life forms right on low tide. They go out there and just pick the life forms that they wanted to eat, eggs, fish, types of marine critters that I don't understand or know anything about, but they could pick all kinds of stuff and take it home, and they got it made. They just wait for low tide. Life was easy. They became great constructors of canoes. This is in the museum in Juneau, and their old stuff was marvelously built. They had the time to paint these paddles. Anytime you see art, you know somebody's got some leisure time. That's a form of wealth. Maybe more wealth than the gold miners had and a lot of other people. I'm not sure at all that they were behind us. They may have been way ahead of us and we didn't realize it. When Columbus first saw the American Indians, he thought they were primitive because they weren't ashamed of their bodies. That was a total value judgment. That's a Christian problem, not an Indian problem. So now, there's a lot of rain there. So they made coats out of the intestines of otters and seals. They are waterproof, they're tough, it's almost like leather. You can sew them together, you slit along the intestine. You say, well, that's kind of gross work. No, it's not. And you know, you'd wash it out in the ocean, it doesn't hurt a thing. And they went out canoeing. And here, the women are getting ready to slice it up, and they've inflated them. And you say, well, I wouldn't put my mouth on an intestine. Well, have you eaten a brat? Have you ever eaten spam? You've eaten worse than intestine. You don't even know what you've eaten. And neither have I, because I've eaten spam. So anyway, they turn hides inside out and oil them if they want to waterproof them. They'd leave them out like this in the cold winter because then it was just snow and you'd be dry. And by the way, here in January, our average temperature is 11 degrees. There, it's 34. So you think, oh, it's too cold. No, it's 20 degrees warmer, more than in the dead of winter. Okay. It's cool all year round, but you can get used to that. And once you're used to it, hey, it's good for you. So they made all kinds of cool stuff. Leather gloves, waterproof gloves, handbags, had to protect their eyes from the sun. You get too much sun with the glare on the eyes, so they reduce the amount of light coming in. They had visors as well. They made jewelry, fine jewelry, all kinds of beautiful stuff. That's another sign of wealth in terms of leisure time. Everything they did, they liked to draw on, carve on. I'm gonna call that an hors d'oeuvre tray. I don't know what it is, but that's what I'd use it for. And they had cones and stuff like that. Scrimshaw, this one over here, the whalebone or something like that. Maybe all those ones are. These are fishing lures down here. That may not look like a fishing lure, but those are what they use for barbs, and fish were so plentiful there. There was enough dumb ones.
Not like the walleyes that bite around the
we've got walleyes that have IQs higher than some humans on it, and they didn't. Okay, so they had it made. They had tackle boxes. They had minnow buckets. They had herring rakes. Herrings are little. They could rake these out of the stream, fill their bag, go home and eat. It was easy. Life was good. That's why they stayed there. They lived in a holy place and life was good. They had indoor games for the winter, cold winters, carved out of bone. They had outdoor games that they played constantly and had a bunch of fun and everybody participated. I like that. It's a value judgment. They were great wood carvers. They were great totem makers. They were great artists in general. And those totems were interesting. I got to talk, and I'll show you this totem maker we talked to, a Tlingit totem maker. And I said, I see humans at the top. I said, is that because they're the controllers, the authorities, they're the leaders? He says, no. We're here to watch and protect the others. So you can see them up there. They have these tall hats sometimes, and they're up there. There's the tall hats. Good stone carvers. They had their own religious story. There, the raven was the hero, right? Had nothing to do with our religious ideas at all. The idea that, all religions are the same. We all believe in the same God, just different names. I've been told that a zillion times. It's just not true. I've traveled 30 nations. That's not true. I'm sorry. And they have their own beliefs. I'm not saying that the story made sense to me. It's full of all kinds of amazing things that happened. I don't have time to talk about it, and really not the authority or knowledge to do it right. But if you were them and someone tried to sell you the story of Christianity and said, okay, virgin birth, do you believe in that? Jonah and the whale, walking on water, seas that part, and on and on and on, would you believe it? If you weren't socialized into it, you're going to have some trouble, I would think. Okay, so here's the story. In 1741, the Russians came, and they had been probably coming before that a little bit, but they began to arrive and hang out a little bit with the Indians, and they were there to trap sea otters, that did not bother the Indians. In fact, in 1795, the Tlingit had had some trouble with the Indians, or with the Russians, decided, hey, let's see if we can make friends with them. So they had a celebration with them in 1795, but fighting erupted soon after that because the Russians were taking their women, taking them back to the ship and making them prisoners, sex prisoners. The Tlingit won't stand for it. And so they chased them off and they burned their settlements in 1802. And then 2 years later, the Russian Navy came with troops and cannons and retook Alaska. When I say Alaska, they retook the little bitty island and the town of Sitka. That's all they took, right? There's only a couple hundred of them there, of Russians that were, keeping watch. And they had to watch all the time because the Indians said, no, you need to get out. You are not worth having around here. You can't do that to our women. And I bet it wasn't just the older women either. Russians, then began to try to force the natives into Christianity. In the Russian Orthodox Christian Church was very much like the Catholic Church, except that they didn't like, they didn't want a pope. They wanted the bishops to do the voting about how we're going to tell the story and what we're going to do. And so, It was Christianity, but it was just a branch of Christianity, just like the Protestant group. But they cut out the middleman. We have chaplains in our army to pat the shoulders on the back as they go forward into battle. Their chaplains, were bishops themselves that did the killing. And so they were both religious Christians, officials and also killers of Indians. And of course, with cannon, they tended to keep the Indians back. This is the Russian bishop's house where the it's now a historic park. You see this? It's a national park. You can go there and see where the Russian bishop lived and all the grandeur that the Russian bishop had. I got to go through it fast. It's pretty pretty glitzy, high tone stuff for the bishop, and they still have it all set up. The bad news is the boarding schools. They started boarding schools, and from what I gathered from looking at the letters Historic Society, is that the ones that would cooperate and wouldn't try to run away to go back home and get away from these Russians, they were saved. The others disappeared. Okay. It is, there's no records, hard to prove. But what we know is the population of the Indians was collapsing quickly, right? So in 1838, the smallpox epidemic that the Russians brought was over, but the Tlingit went back to kick them out. And in 1867, Russia got tired of fighting it and decided to sell Alaska. It's something they didn't own. It's like me telling you, I'm going to sell this building. Do I have a bid? You know, I don't own this building. But you, if you bid and you buy it and you've got cannons, you can keep it. You know what I mean? And if you think this is a little odd, think about where you're sitting now. What was this? This was a Louisiana purchase. I got to go back over here with a mic. I'm used to walking around here. I just have to run in place. The Louisiana purchase, the Mille Lacs band didn't know anything about it. Neither did the Red Lake band or any of these people back there. But the French stuck their flag in the ground and said, okay, we own this all the way up to Canada. You know, they're in New Orleans saying, okay, we own it up to Canada. You know, and the Indians didn't even know about it. And then, you know, Thomas Jefferson bought it from the French. Bought what? I mean, the French were fencing stolen goods. We're sitting on it, right? I'm not saying I want to give my house up. I'm just saying we've got some rethinking to do about our history, right? Okay, so moving on. So this is the Russian Orthodox Church, but they look like they cross a little different. Here's another one. And here they are handing it over. The Russian bishops out here in front, handing it over to the United States. You can see the US flag here waving, over here waving. And you see there's a few Indians that seem to be in the background here, the ones that knuckled under and went along with the Russians' game. Okay, so all of this took place in Sitka. Nothing happened up here. No one up there knew anything about it. And to see this territory that you don't own, and then for the U.S. to have bought it, you know, and it was less than 2 cents an acre we paid for it, but it doesn't matter. We, you know, this, it's a ridiculous story, but it's an epic story too of how we got basically rid of this civilization, or tried to. The good news is, hang on for it. they're coming back, okay? Now this is the Tlingit, I'll let you read that, what the Tlingit chief said about this sale. You're done. Okay. I got to move so fast. We put this terrible person, this is Jefferson Davis, but he was not the Jefferson Davis of the Confederacy, a different one, but he was an Indian killer. Although he's a Yankee, he'd killed a lot of Indians, and he had shot another officer, and to punish him rather than put him in jail, they gave him this duty, which was terrible duty up in Alaska. And then the killing began. Now, the Russians had been shelling their villages. Now we just got right behind them, did the same thing, boarding schools, shelling their villages. Read this, starting here. Okay, so proud of the killing, explosive devices laying all over there, and then the boarding schools. This is one of the famous pictures. I almost call this, please don't speak Eskimo, because look at the sign over here in our boarding school, US boarding school. Please do not speak Eskimo. It was about stopping their culture, cutting their hair, making them wear our kind of clothes, and keeping them away from their parents. The same thing was happening all over Canada. Just recently found mass graves around these places where they killed the uncooperative students. And I think the same thing has happened all over America. We haven't looked. Canada's looking. They got a new technology that can x-ray the ground and see the graves, mass graves. And I think if we did this too, we had 16 places in Minnesota. Here's, and they're all over the US. This is Pennsylvania. This is Oregon. This is Washington. And this is Minnesota. Here they're being forced to salute the flag of the people that took them away from their parents. And here we dressed them up like little soldiers, the same uniform basically as the people that killed off their culture. Pipestone, Minnesota. And if you're not convinced yet, I own this thing. I like to step on it. But this is a game the Little Indians game where you make the Indians disappear. The Little Indians, by the way. And then there were none. Do you see that? And you know, can you make them all disappear? You push this button, it rolls these dice, and then you can, whatever the number is, you can basically eliminate that Indian. See where, this is 1968, and look what was made. Minneapolis, Minnesota. Not this college. Events after 67. Okay, so we, 13 years, we shelled them, all right? And then the, unfortunately, right off after we bought it, the gold rush hits. And that was a massive disaster for the, for everybody. I'm gonna go for the city. Okay. And look at all the people that were going to the gold rush, right? They could, the boats were full to standing room only, and they went up to make their fortunes. And who were they? Look at all these people going up the mountain. They were young, uneducated white males, okay? And they're all in the age of sexual activity, and there's no appropriate sexual partners. And they're going up there by the zillions and mining and staying, occasionally going to the hotel to take a shower, I suppose. But the hotels were, according to the, what I've learned, almost all of them houses of prostitution, right? And there were no women that came up. So naturally, the people that were the targets were the Indians. And this would, I would say this is probably one of the most depraved moments in human history, never mind US history, about what happened there. If you read the letters and check this out, I've been doing it for years now. It's just, it's borders on the unbelievable. Sex trafficking. And it's interesting, when the pipeline was being put in here, twice, a couple of pipes line workers were caught sex trafficking. And they were Indians that were being targeted. There's a big problem right now with sex trafficking in Minnesota. It's the same thing, workers coming in with no appropriate sexual partners. And of course they were taking the game. So the Indians now, they couldn't hunt the game out as easily out in the wild, and the coasts that they used to hang out with were full of miners who were intentionally eroding the soil to wash their gold, wrecking all the places they would have gotten their food. So the population was a big trouble, and it collapsed. And this sign, this is a representation of the collapse right here. From 60,000, it could have said 80,000, but I'm trying to be conservative here. No, don't need to exaggerate, because look at what happened. Now this was on, under the Russians. Here we came in here, and it looks like a little better, but then it even got worse. After, you know, and during the gold rush. And I don't have all the data points I'd like to have had to make this up, but that's what I had. And here's the white population in the gray, right? Here's the Russian population. We told them to get out, that we need the houses, but they, a lot of them didn't leave, and some of them began to multiply. And so there's still a Russian presence there, and a pretty significant in Alaska. Well, the worst thing happened in 1904 in terms of being official. We end, we hereby end your cultures. The governor, and who is also a Presbyterian missionary, John Brady, decreed an official end to Alaskan Indian culture, traditions, and language. And some people yet see him as a good guy. And so it must be mentioned that he said, but we should stop killing them. And this raping isn't right either. And he collected their artifacts. You know, I think maybe just to get them away from them. I don't know. And he thought that they would just give up their culture because we're going to give you citizenship. You can be like us. In fact, you have to be. Language, no more. Don't speak Eskimo anymore or whatever their language was, et cetera, et cetera. So he was really quite a character. And in 1912, Alaska became a state, but by then the population had fallen 23% further since what I last showed you, since the Russian takeover. And Indians were allowed to vote if literate, which was their way of keeping them from voting. What's literacy? You know, they want to, you know, they'd have to read our language, you know, their oral language and their art and the things that were language to them didn't count. So they couldn't vote, although a few did. And as they more and more voted, they got some power. So here's that Governor Brady, the Presbyterian minister and governor, that ended their culture, at least he thought he did. And this was their last potlatch. In 1968, there was a massive discovery at Prudhoe Bay. An oil rush started, now an oil rush. And 20 years later, the largest oil spill in history hit the Exxon Valdez. It killed all those critters. And in 2021, a bill came up partly because of Obama, who went up there to visit them and raise to the Indians, to visit the Indians, first president ever. And he hung out with them a bit, and that raised the esteem and the interest in doing something for the Indians. That's where the crash was, the Exxon oil crash. It came from Prudhoe Bay pipeline to here and lasted 1,300 miles of stuff. Crashed the fishing industry entirely. White people got hurt on that one. And so a lot of people, boats went to rot, or they lost them. The glaciers are melting because of that oil, which is sort of interesting. It's got to be part of this too. But Obama did raise the spirits, and I know that he's a Democrat. And I've given money to Republicans in the past, Len Sherwood and Arnie Carlson. That's true. I just try to pick people who care. And so it mattered that he went up there and I was happy. That bill has been caught up in conference, and it has not gone anywhere. Maybe it has by now, and I don't know it. I hope it gets through. And we finally recognize the tribes that haven't even been recognized, nor have they have ever had a reservation, nor have we ever signed a treaty with them. We've treated them worse than our Indians, which have been treated horribly. Sorry to say. And so here is the success, though. The success starts here. After they get the vote, things start looking bad, right? Their population was here when we got here. And we're looking at the big picture, so that dip is not as obvious. But you can see from here to here was a halving of their population and more. And then here, now they're above it. So things are getting better for them. I'm sure you're glad to see that. Now they've got some voting power. So they are protesting certain things. They are making this is that totem maker. He's a Tlingit, making their totem poles. They are evolving, making all kinds of cool music. These people are amazing. Is this it? Okay, now bear with me for about a minute. We've got to switch CDs here. And cue it up. Because I'm going to start in the middle of a cut. And this is the modern music. And you'll hear singing and instruments, especially the didgeridoo, which they are in love with up there in Alaska. Now, I'll let you hand right here. Okay, it's got to load up. So, I looked through all the Alaskan music.
Keep talking.
This is a live album. And this one seemed to be the most popular. And their music was amazing. You just don't expect, knowing their background, all the jazz and rock and even soul and things like that. But they like some of our culture, right? They are our culture now. And I think we should be proud of them because, they're Americans now, and we're Americans. Everybody was born here. We're all Native Americans. We should embrace them as the replacement for Columbus. Okay, so is it just hit play now? Do I need to click on this, or did you already do it for me?
No, you need to do it too.
Okay. Well, here goes. We're trying. Okay. Oh, I gotta set it up. Okay, it's all right. That's close enough. Here we go. And then hit that, and then hit this. Okay.
Yeah, I'm just going to do that.
Okay, so it ended. I got a little slow getting this going here, but we're done and we're about out of time. But if you want to ask questions, I'm ready to make something up. And you don't feel like you have to be. Anybody?
Yeah, I have a question.
Go ahead.
Modern Native Americans, modern Asian Americans, how do they see each other?
That's a good question, and I can't.
Can you repeat the question?
Okay, yeah. Here? The question was, as far as I can tell, how do modern Asians and modern American Indians see each other? And I really can't answer that. I know that there's going to be a difference. When I was working on my PhD over at South Dakota State University, I was working with a guy named Roger Clemega, and he was a black man from Ghana. And the other black students did not know how to deal with him at all. Were they supposed to feel inferior because they had been slaves? Or should they look down on him because he came from a poorer country? You know what I mean? They didn't know exactly how to relate. Eventually he had some black friends, but it took a while. You know, as soon as people get to know each other, then the understanding starts. And that's why I'm doing this, is that, you know, you see these people, you realize they're great. You know, we should be proud to have them take over the Columbus myth. But
I ask because the Asian culture is so family driven, and just wondering where the two separate.
Well, I suggest you spend about 2 or 3 years researching it, because I don't know. I think that would take a lot. That'd be a good master's thesis or something. You know, seriously, I wish I could answer it.
This question is interesting. That's what I was going to kind of ask. Like some of us are Caucasian, and they consider there supposed to be like 3 classes of different kinds of people or human beings. Asian. Black, but I don't know that to be all thrown out.
Well, we're so intermixed now that, and maybe that's one of the good things about the intermixing, is that after a while the distinctions don't matter.
Yeah,
they shouldn't have mattered ever. I mean, we're all Africans. Anybody who makes fun of Africans is making fun of themselves, right? These Asians are Africans, so are we, and I'm proud of all of it. You know, there weren't any, the idea of some races being backward or something. If really biologically, in some way, some inherent way, that some race was really inferior, evolution would have wiped them out a long time ago. We've been through millions of years. Lucy, I stood next to Lucy, the skeleton is 3 million years old. She was erectus. And I got a picture of Mary standing next to her. And, over 3 million years, things get sorted out. You know, intelligence and all kinds of abilities. And everybody that's alive, everybody in this room, everybody that's alive today has got, you know, their people had something going on, or else they wouldn't be here. And if we could just start sharing that, it would be a lot better. Yeah.
What is the level of support for the recognition and the treasuring of the Native population of Alaska among the white Alaskans? Is there a level of support for that? You said the population is rising. There's also, can we observe a rising in acceptance and attitude and inclusion and welcome?
Well, I think this bill is really, is the symbol of what you're talking about. If it passes, there's going to be some changes there. And I think it's going to pass, but, you know, and I've been up there 4 times, but that doesn't give me a good enough feel for the white Alaskans and what they think. Certainly there's a lot of racism there. And part of the reason that they didn't want treaties is they wanted all that land for themselves. The U.S. Army was supposed to be enforcing the law to keep these Indians safe, But they, you know, they were also single white men with low education that, you know, wanted sex objects. And they were part of the problem. It was the, you know, the West was never wilder, I'll put it that way. And that, a lot of that is left up there. There's a whole very strong contingent of ultra-conservative, really white supremacist folks up there. But they're not everybody. And I think things are changing. You know, as Martin Luther King said, you know, the arc of history is long, but it bends towards justice. I hope he's right. It sure is jagged sometimes. And white supremacy is on the rise in this nation. I mean, I teach a criminology class, and hatred groups are rising not only in numbers, but in population within each group. I mean, it's gone crazy. And so have attacks by them. But this is, you know, it's a cyclical, I hope. You know, we put this down in the 40s with World War II. And I don't know what's going to happen this time. I don't know if it's going to continue much longer, or if people are just going to relax and accept the fact that there's other people here than just white folks, and that they're good people, you know?
Go ahead. So about the bill, you said that, what exactly would it do for the Native peoples, and also why hasn't it been passed, do you think?
Okay. Actually, yes, I didn't even hear it myself. You can drop your mask for a second.
So what would the bill do for the Native peoples, and also why do you think it hasn't been passed already?
Well, I think racism is the reason it hasn't passed. But the problem is, the benefit from it would be, you know, once they're officially recognized, they're going to get some extra rights. I don't know what they are going to be, you know what I mean? But once they're recognized, people are going to have to say, well, then what should they have? Because a lot of them have nothing. And, you know, rights without any property or any equity are not, you know, it's like you're free to do what? Freedom's just another word for nothing left to lose. You know what I mean? I didn't make that up, actually.
But go ahead.
How long ago did the Ojibwe arrive right here? Do you know that?
I don't know. Maybe someone here does. But they were mostly an East Coast group,
right?
That, you know, they had begun to move west, partly because of white pressure. And then they had to move west because of white pressure. And that's why the Dakotas and the Ojibwe fought here. Because the Dakota had the land rights, and you know, now they didn't hate the Ojibwe, but I mean, you know, they are on our land. You know what I mean? And so, like, wait a minute here, and so that was a problem. But it was more recent than, you know, but they'd already gone all the way east. They were newcomers to America. You know what I mean? They'd gone further than the Dakotas in some ways. So,
Gary, I want to point out on this picture right here. It looks like games going on. But it originates from when they wanted to see a breaching whale up 2-3 miles away, they would throw the people up, usually the lightest with good eyesight. So,
well,
but now it's become games now. Yeah.
Well, that's interesting. I hadn't heard that.
Yeah. Yeah.
And now the gentleman said that this, what we're looking at here right now, is people being thrown up in the air, maybe for games, but back in the day, it was about seeing if they could see a whale spout. And I've been out there, and that's how they look for them. They look for a blow, and then, you know, it's time to go, you know, after him. So that was the, thanks for adding that, appreciate it.
I was wondering if the oral traditions are being written down and saved, and if the native languages are being taught in schools, like Ojibwe is being taught in Minnesota now.
Well, they are in some places, certainly in terms of the questions, are languages being saved and written down? Of course, they might even say, we don't have to, it's verbal. You know what I mean? We do pretty good with verbal. Nevertheless, I agree with you if you're implying that they should be written down. I think so too. And they are being, and that is being done well from what I can gather. And these letters and stuff that they're keeping, there's a significant part of this white population that is doing everything they can to save this while these elders are still alive. And I'm really glad to see that. And they inspire me and made me want to do this. So that people realize what we've got here. We've got ourselves a great story. And actually, I think I've been trying to contact Ken Burns. Dude, This is the story. This is the story of America. This is the most important thing. And they didn't just give this language. They brought you half the food you eat. They gave us, you know, there's a book here, Indian Givers, that you should read about all the foods. Peanuts, corn, tomatoes, potatoes, squash, cassava, which is not important here, but way south it is, and all kinds of stuff. Chocolate. I've given away all the chocolate. But I was thinking about bringing a bag of chocolate, but the more people showed up here than I thought would, and thank you for coming. Life without chocolate, think about that. Thank an Indian. Every time you give chocolate, some say, thank an Indian, please. And they eat corn, say, thank an Indian, please. And tomatoes, potatoes, really? Do you want to be without them? You know, ketchup is tomatoes. You have fresh fries and then ketchup. You know what I mean? Actually, we're probably better off without the French fries, but at any rate, they gave us all kinds of stuff. And if we hadn't had that, our lives would be a lot less. You know, the English had what? Cabbage and broccoli. That's why we came here, to get away from each other. But at any rate, I'm fried, and I've got to do this again tonight, and I won't have any voice if I go much longer. But I sure appreciate you being here, and I love your questions. And come get tonight. It'll be with my laser projector, which I have sitting right there right now tonight, and it'll be a crowd that probably has more public in it. But it was really gratifying to see this many people, and Andrea and Tracy and Darren Flansburg and Brent Balmer, all these people worked on this to make this work, because this was hard to do. So thank you all for coming, and thanks to them.
Thank you for coming.